Kakamega Forest is Kenya's only tropical forest and is distinguishably rich in biodiversity but threatened by agricultural encroachment and other forms of human activity. Like in many parts of the developing world, there is a growing upsurge in demand for herbal and other traditional remedies for various ailments among communities in Kenya. Our guest tonight, James Ligare from Shinyalu in Kakamega County, dipped himself in the know-how of various uses of herbal plants or shrubs into medical value for his community. His desire is to conserve the forest while giving the community an alternative to grow the herbs around them.
I was engaged in raising indigenous tree seedlings and selling to the community for agroforestry and also doing reforestation in the Kakamega rainforest.
But what pushed this entrepreneur into this new venture?
What prompted me was because of the poverty level around this Kakamega forest, and you get most of the communities around here are very poor, and they have no alternative income generating. That's why I decided to venture into this project of medicinal plant enterprise. Traditionally, we use these plants to cure ourselves because of flu, chest congestion. So we could go to the forest, harvest the plants, bring at home and then boil it, and then fumigate whoever was feeling unwell. And then we get, when he sweats, when he inhales the steam, he gets relieved. So it is from that kind of curiosity that I developed to know really what was in this plant that was making these people was feeling unwell to be cured.
Whatever you engage in prior to your new ventures could end up as a venue to assist you in startups.
Initially we had no money, but after raising the tree seedlings and selling the tree seedlings, we got in some little money, and it was like 500,000. Then I came and solicited some funds from a loan. Then I started the project.
As an entrepreneur, you can have a good idea, but an expert hand or advice in your business can push you miles ahead.
In fact, before I even started the project, I liaised with the research institutions to come and assist in the research, because I had not capacity in developing the concept in the medicinal plant.
Who knew that trees could produce all these products?
Currently we have two products. We have the natural balm. This one is used for flu, cold, chest congestion, insect bites, and is the only balm on the market that you can apply on an insect bitten. All the others that we have, you can't apply on an insect bitten place. You either swell or it irritates the skin. But our balm, the balm that I produce is used for the insect bites, cold, flu, chest congestion.
Having seen the state of the community around him, James wanted to give them a chance and be a part of the enterprise.
Currently we have four people working on the medicinal plant enterprise. We have the youth who assist in the distillation of the medicinal plant, then the extraction of the essential oil. Then we have another youth also working on the marketing of the products. We have others who are working in the farm. And then what the medicinal plant entails also is empowering the community economically. So the enterprise has done has commissioned other community members. Currently we have 400 farmers who are working on the plant. So we buy the leaves from the community members, and then we process it into the essential oil, and then finally making the products.
What medicinal plants are used to extract these oils for medicine?
Currently I'm working on three plants. We have the Osmum Kilimansharikam. The Osmum Kilimansharikam is the main one. This is what we have commissioned farmers are planting currently. And then we have the Osmum Suave. The Osmum Suave, I just require very little quantity of oil, but this one is the main one because this is the only plant that will give you the crystals. You'll see the crystals and the oil. And the third one where you see farmers doing cultivation is the third one, the Lipia ucumbentis. That one also produces oil, but the oil is different from this other oil, and we are using it, all the three plants, to make the natural products. We are now in the distillation room. So after harvesting the material in the farm, the material is brought in the drying bander. It is dried for 3 to 4 days. And then after the drying, we pack the dried material in the canny bags, and we weigh 10 kilograms of the dried material, and it is brought in here for distillation. So after the material has been brought here for distillation, we use this hydro distiller machine to extract the essential oil. So the hydro distiller has two main chambers. We have the main chamber where we put the dried material. We soak using 80 liters of water. And then we have the outer chamber known as the water jacket. So the water jacket is now where we put our water to heat the material. So we heat through conduction. That is, we don't heat the material directly, because if you heat the material directly, then the oil cloudbursts will evaporate. Then after, we use the gas to heat the material, because currently we don't have any power. And then when the material is heated for like 2 hours, the vapor comes, the steam, through this arm. It comes up to this condenser. Inside this condenser, we have 18 tubes where the hot steam comes. And this is a countercurrent kind of cooling system. So the cold water comes and then it cools the steam. And then we have our distillate. So the distillate has two components. We have the water and the oil. So the oil floats on top, and then the water in downwards. So the water is pressed by the oil and it comes to this side. So this is what we use to separate the oil and the water. We have harvested all the rain waters on these buildings, and we have dug an underground tank. So we use the rain harvested water to collect it in the underground tank, and we use solar to pump the water from the underground tank up to the reservoir tank. Then the water is recycled.
Such inventions will not go unnoticed, and James tells us who and from where he has seen his medical actions help the community.
We have gotten a lot of recognitions. First of all, in 2010, we were recognized by the Equator Initiative. This is an initiative that is held by UNEP and UNTP. And then the same year, also 2010, we were recognized by the SEED Initiative. I had the pleasure to go and receive the recognition in Pretoria, South Africa. And most recently, during the Green Innovation Award that was held by Netfund, we were the overall winners, and we got 2 million. So we intend to upscale whatever we are doing with the money. And we shall be working with Gritty to see how they can assist us in capacity building so that we can improve our production system. Gritty is the Kenya Institute of Research and Development Institute.
Talking of his future plans.
My future plan is to improve this thing and make it one of the center of excellence in terms of herbal medicines. Yeah, where we can bring in traditional herbalists to come and even learn more from what we are doing and see how we can help one another. We are coming up with a botanical garden where we want to plant all the medicinal plants that are found in Kakamega.
Giving advice to anyone interested in this herbal medicine venture, James talks of the enormous opportunities.
What I'll tell whoever is so interested in the herbal medicine, I'll tell him that first of all, we have a lot of indigenous knowledge that has never been tapped. So it is good to document this traditional knowledge, because from this traditional knowledge we can have bigger industries coming up because of the indigenous knowledge. You remember, we don't have anywhere that we have documented any traditional, indigenous knowledge. And the indigenous knowledge we have can really help us in job creation, like you see here.
Are you sitting at home and saying there is no work? James has one piece of advice of how one move could open doors for you.
Surely you can't say there is no work when you are just sitting idle. You need to do something. Someone somewhere will see whatever you are doing and you'll come in and you'll find that you have an opportunity in whatever you are doing. So don't just sit back and wait for maybe something to come from heaven. No, you have to do something so that someone somewhere will see you and will come to assist you.
Most entrepreneurs have that one thing that keeps them going. As for James,
what keeps me going is, first, I don't like giving up. There is nothing that I will start doing and then give up. I need to do it to my level best. So that is what challenges me, and I like facing challenges and turning these challenges into opportunities.
If you have any comments on tonight's entrepreneur, leave a comment on our Facebook page, KTN The Entrepreneur, or reach us on our Twitter handle, KTN The Entrepreneur.
Biogas typically refers to a mixture of different gases produced by the breakdown of organic matter in the absence of some oxygen. Biogas can be cleaned and upgraded to natural gas standards when it becomes biomethane.
Okay.
Our next guest, James Njuguna, has gone against all odds despite his disability and has managed to start a unique venture in his home area as he capitalizes on a niche he found in giving renewable energy that is affordable.
Where we are now in Winner in Bahati, where I have a plant whereby I'm harnessing and condensing biogas and packing it into gas cylinders.
Having been in another business, the worst happened during the post-election violence and he lost a part of his hand, which was a big blow for him.
Before I started, I had a transport business. I had my own vehicles and I was driving one. But immediately, when during post-election violence, that's where I met with these people. They chopped off my hand, so I could not drive anymore. So after that, the drivers took advantage of disturbing me and throwing keys to me. So they know very well I cannot drive.
Losing a part of his hand made James feel like he had been thrown into the deep end. But this did not make him lose all hope. In fact, it motivated him to look for another way of making it.
So I decided, what can I do to earn a living? I sat down and I thought, I have to come up with a very unique business. I did not want to copy anybody's business. So I started off thinking, what can I do? So immediately I came up with an idea. How can I harness biogas, which is biomethane? I pack it into gas cylinders. I sell them to people. So my produce from the vehicle, so I invested here. And I started to roll it out. Pole. The project has taken me about 2.5 years.
Hapa ndo malitukisha hii corona.
I have spent between 400 and 500,000. That is from my own savings. And totally from my own. I have not got anybody's money.
The decision of cleaning the county of Nakuru ended up being an advantage to him in terms of business expansion and source of raw materials.
Initially, when I started it, I had a problem of the byproduct. because you have to get the cow dung to produce to sufficient it, and then you just start producing biogas. So what I did, I went to town. There's those people who have grazed zero grazing. They have a problem because their bees sued by the county government because of the disposals. Because the cows that I had, they are too small for this digester because the digester is so big. So I normally collect cow dung from Nakuru Estates, and then I drop it here. I start my process. Now when I bring it here, if you can see there, I have piled them, and then I funica it with that plastic polythene. Now I normally take about 3 wheelbarrows per day. I wash them, I take out the residues, and then the cow dung itself, I pump it to the my digester so that it can produce gas. And then I pipe it inside here, and that's why I do my processing of condensing it and scrapping it. Yes.
A past experience gave James an idea of his next business. And who exactly does he target with his cheap fire, as he calls it?
During that post-elections, the gas was so high, such that I think one day I bought 4,300, which was too expensive. And that is where, in fact, the initial idea came in. And out of that, I have been seeing our forests being destroyed. So I came up with that idea, because if at all, God willing, and whatever now I'm doing here, I'll be selling my gas at 100 shillings per kilo, so that I can target 3 kilos cylinders, 6 kilos, and 13, because I want to go to the slums themselves. Yeah.
Any new innovation will have its own challenges, and James narrates of his.
Now the biggest challenge, because the breakthrough is there, but the biggest challenge that I'm having, it is this gas, the cylinders. Because I was told, if at all I start packing in the other company's cylinders, they're going to sue me through the Energy Regulatory Board. So I had to stop my project until when I get sponsors so that they can facilitate for the cylinders.
Now, being a pilot project, what is the available capacity?
The storage tank that I'm having, it can produce about 70 to 113 kg cylinders. But if at all we could have 3 kilos and 6 kilos, then the production would be higher because the volume is a little bit low. So for 3 and 6, I can produce about 300 to 350 cylinders. Now the process, it starts from the outside now, it's the normal biogas process, and right now where the technology is now, it is inside this house, because once we produce our biogas from that end, it starts here. This is called a scrapper. This is where we remove our sulfur, and we try to clean the gas because of the smell. After that, my machine here, this is the first condenser. It rotates inside this machine. Then after rotating inside this machine, it goes to the other one here. This is another condenser. This is just an improvisation of the normal cooling system, but we have improvised it. After that, the gas goes back outside there to the storage. That's where we have condensed it. And then after that, it comes back here. When it comes back through this pipe, this is my compressor. It is being compressed here. And then after that, I have a small cylinder here, which the gas now comes in, and the second time, it passes through these machines. Now it is condensed. If you can feel, it's very cold right now. This is where now we start packing it to the gas cylinders. This is an injection nozzle, and this is a cylinder.
What do the recipients of James Cheap Fire think of it?
The response is very good, because this fire is just like, it's just the same like the one that we use as LPG. Biomethane is just like the time it's taking, it is a normal time that you can take cooking the same time with the LPG. So, and the gas, my gas is cheap. So the market will not be very harsh for me, and it is not. The demand is so high.
With the response being very positive, how about marketing the product?
Marketing of this product is it's not very, because it's not very harsh, because it is a product that it is selling by itself. In fact, from the day that I was being awarded, there are a lot of telephones have been coming in. We want to place orders. We want to come. So everybody is excited and want to see the cheap fire I'm giving people. So the demand is so high, such that it is unbelievable.
If you have ideas of venturing into this green energy space, hear what one who has been there has to say.
The advice that I can give them is that, I have the pilot project. They can consult me, I can assist them, and then if at all it is possible, it's good that we have the other branches in Eldoret, in Kisumu, everywhere, so that we can minimize our transport to them.
Despite being disabled, nothing deterred James to venture into entrepreneurship. And you who is saying there is no work, listen to this.
We have a lot of resources, the natural things that we have. We can come up with an idea. And this is one of the ideas that I'm having. I had this challenge and I never went back because I saw that I will make it even if I'm disabled. And to them, just do your homework. Just do your research. You come up with an idea that instead of staying home, you definitely get a breakthrough. And there's a lot of money.
Innovations that will conserve the environment will definitely get some recognition.
Yes, I got one, which was embraced by the First Lady in Nairobi. There's another recognition because I've been invited in Stockholm in Sweden in April because of the same project. And I think God willing, I'll be there.
James sees a bright future countrywide.
My future plans is to roll this thing worldly, the whole Kenya, and targeting the big towns because that is where a lot of charcoal is being taken and our forests are deforested kabisa because I'm targeting the low income in earners, kabisa completely in the slums.
If you have any comments on tonight's entrepreneur, leave a comment on our Facebook page, KTN The Entrepreneur, or reach us on our Twitter handle, KTN The Entrepreneur.